Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, I thank you for each one here. Lord, I just pray that we would humbly be at your feet, Lord, to receive what you have for us this day. Lord, I pray that you would use Pastor Izzy to teach us, to show us your way, your love, and your grace and your mercy, which are new every morning. And pray, Lord, that we wouldn't just hear it today and walk away unfulfilled, but Lord, we would use it and apply it to our life that we could walk differently. Lord, I pray for Brooke today, Lord, that you would open her heart, soften all of our hearts, Lord, that we can receive from you. We ask that now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, we're going to come to the last two of the fruits of the Spirit in the list that Paul gave us in Galatians chapter 5. If you'd like to look on with me in verse 22, Galatians 5:22 is the passage we read about the fruit of the Spirit. Now, it starts with the word but the fruit of the Spirit. And then whenever you have that little three-letter word but, you have to remember it's in English they call it a disassociative conjunctive. I learned that. That's a big word. In school, we had to learn that, you know, it takes the thought that was given before it, it connects it to the thought that is going to come, but in the form of the opposite. So what came before the fruits of the Spirit? Do you guys remember this? It's been a while since I backed up to put it in the context, but I have to today because we're coming to the end of it, and I want to show you what Paul does as he describes the fruits of the Spirit. He contrasts the fruits of the Spirit with what's called the deeds of the flesh. So if you back up just to verse 19, he says, actually go to verse 18. If you are led by the Spirit, you know, by God's Spirit, it says, then you're not under the law. Because we're going to see if you have the fruits of the Spirit, it says against such things as these fruits, there really is no law. You don't need a rule to say be nice if you're filled with the fruit of the Spirit of kindness. You're already going to be doing it. And so Paul is contrasting this life that we, before I came to Christ, let me tell you, the deeds of the flesh, what it says in Corinthians, they are evident. And some of us walked more in them than others. And so it's not like I never had a problem. You know, when the Bible says that we, you know, walked in the flesh and our carnal nature, I never felt like the minister was mad at me. I just figured he had spied on me because... You know, he knew all the stuff I was doing. And how did he know? He didn't even hang out with me. But it's not he was spying on me. You know, the Holy Spirit is tattling on all of us before we walk it by the Spirit. There's only two choices, by the way. You either walk after your fleshly, carnal nature, or you walk by the Spirit of God and experience the fruits of His Spirit. And the fruits of the Spirit, they're awesome when you get to grow in these things because you find out the rules... The rule is what I call the law of God. Is it hard to keep all those rules when you're really full of the Spirit? No. But it says, but we have to walk, and we're going to see today in the end of this chapter, chapter 5 of Galatians, that walking by the Spirit is going to entail that walking by the Spirit will make us overcome the flesh. We won't be doing the things of the flesh because we'll be busy. Just, you know, some people are like, I can't stop doing the things of the flesh. I'm like, you don't. I try to explain this to the young guys at the college and career group. It's really hard to say, let's stop doing this bad habit. What's better to do, because we are creatures of habit, whether you like it or not. I'm sorry to side digress on this note, but are we not creatures of habit? Art was telling me, what breakfast do you eat each day? This morning, oatmeal, some fruit in it, and, you know, same breakfast. He goes, I hate to say it, but I eat the same breakfast all the time. And, you know, I did this drug-free bodybuilding thing for EAS Corporation. They had the little magazine, and they do the befores and the after transformations, you know. And one of the articles in that magazine pointed out that people on average... They only rotate their breakfast choices between three different breakfasts all year long. I mean, if you're an oatmeal lover, it's oatmeal. If it's pancakes or if it's, you know, grits and bacon and eggs or whatever it is that you there's certain meals that you like. And so they were trying to point out that, you know, everyone's trying to learn how to eat healthy and everything. And they said, all you have to do is find out which one of those three breakfasts that you already choose, maybe they're not such, there's something, a component that's not that healthy. Don't try to change your whole eating thing. Just take the one thing that's unhealthy in that meal and replace it. Don't get rid of the meal. Just replace the one unhealthy thing with a healthy substitute. Create a new habit. And they didn't. It's amazing how freeing that is for some people to learn that, wow, I don't have to change the whole thing. I just got to take the bad junk, substitute with the good stuff, and the rest of it still works. You know, it really doesn't take that much to change these things. But it's because we are creatures of habit. They went on to say there was typically five lunches that people choose from. How many dinners do you think we choose from rotating through our culinary, you know, expertise and diversity of our diet? Seriously, realistically, for the women, they could tell you exactly. The ones that are cooking it, they know. But realistically, guys, how many meals do we, you know, vacillate between in dinners? They say 7 to 10. And if you've gotten those 7 to 10, maybe there's one of them that's your kind of free eating meal. You go crazy. Eat all the junk food and everything and call it dinner. But, you know, Twinkies and ice cream and all that doesn't really count for dinner. But some people, that's a dinner sometimes. It's just what's in the cupboard. They just pointed out you need to put the good stuff, substitute that. Put the good habit in place of that thing, what you're doing as a bad. Don't say, I'm going to quit doing that bad thing. I'm going to stop, but I'm not going to put anything in its place, because we're wired where there's a gap. There'll be a gap there. We have to put something in that slot. And this is so beautiful, the wisdom what the Lord gives to us here in the letter that Paul writes to the church at Galatia. By the way, the Galatian church, Galatia's a region. It had a whole group of churches. So he's writing to a whole bunch of different churches. And he's telling them, guys, you got to walk by the Spirit to overcome the flesh. You can't just say, I'm going to stop being carnal and fleshly. It doesn't work. You have to substitute the right thing to do in place of the wrong thing that you used to do. So he told us here, the flesh in verse 17, well, I'm sorry, I should have backed all the way up to verse 16. He says, I say to you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit against the flesh. He says, and these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. Can anyone give an amen to this, that your flesh is in opposition to your Spirit? Have you ever felt like a push and a pull? Inwardly, you know, your spirit's like, I want to do the right thing. And the flesh is on the outward going, no, don't, you know, don't do it. He says, but if you're led by the Spirit, look at verse 18, then you are not under the law. Now, the deeds of the flesh, they're evident, which is immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying. Envyings. Did you notice it's in the list here a couple times? Drunkenness, carousings, and things like these, of which he says, I forewarn you. What? Some people don't take heed to this warning, but you should. He says, I tell you that those that walk in these things, that practice these things, they shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not think that walking in the flesh is acceptable with God. It's not. When that guy Nicodemus came to him at night, he was a religious leader, he said, what do I have to do to have everlasting life? You remember that? And Jesus said to him, you must be born again. And the guy goes, how can I get back in my mother's womb a second time? I can't go back in there. You know, I'm full grown. I wouldn't fit. No, he didn't say it like, but you get the idea, right? And Jesus goes, are you a teacher of Israel? You know, one of these spiritual teachers, and you don't understand this? he says that which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. He says, unless a man be born again. And by the way, when some people say, do you believe in being born again? I'm like, well, yeah. Where'd you get that teaching? Let me think. Who said it? Jesus. I think he pretty much knows what we need. And if we need to be born again, he's talking about, yes, you are born into this. He uses the very example of the lingo of their day. That which is born of the water is, well, the earthly. When a woman's, you know, water breaks, they say, here comes the baby. That's the flesh being born. But the things he says of the Spirit, that's what you have to, you've had the first birth, you have to have a second birth. That's why we call it being born again. But the second birth is that birth of your Spirit within you. And that, when that happens, guys, life, man, it's like the light comes on. Life just changes. It's a joy. I can't even express it. It's just inexpressible how great it is to have that knowledge that I'm now alive to God inside. There was a part of me I know was dead to God. I didn't need a preacher to tell me. I knew. I just didn't know how to do something about it. And I love that Paul, this apostle, who he says, who was the chiefest amongst the sinners. That's what he called himself. Some people say, you have a bad self-image, Pastor. You said you sin. And you are a really bad sinner. I said, I don't have a bad self-image. I have a realistic self-image. I know that I was sinning. I didn't wake up in the morning and say, hey, I wonder if I shouldn't sin today. I had it, you know, just laying on the bed when I woke up, I'm thinking of which sins should I do and how much. Let's be realistic. I wasn't saying, I don't think I should sin. I was plotting my sin. And I didn't know how to do anything different because that's the ways of the flesh. I was born into this fleshly realm. I had the first birth down. I didn't have the second one, though. And it would take a man that was also showed great grace from God to tell me that God showed him grace and forgave him, and God wanted to show me grace and forgive me. And he wanted to come and make me now alive to God from within, a second birth of my spirit, that I could now experience life on a whole greater level than I ever was walking in before. You know, one of the things that really, I don't know about you, but when I learned that Christ, how much sin does he forgive when we ask him? All, right? David, when David sinned with Bathsheba, he wrote a psalm, Psalm 51. We sing that psalm, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit with me. And he actually goes on and says, and cast me not away from your what? Your presence. He could sense God's presence. But when he sinned, you know, when we sin, the Bible says, well, the psalmist wrote it. It is my sin which has separated me from thee, O God. You know, we feel like God is far away when we're in sin. But in 1 John, if we walk in the light, it says, as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus cleanses us of our sin. And one more cool thing, he cleanses my sin, cleanses your sin, and we have a thing called fellowship. Where you might even know that person, but in the Lord, there's this sweet, sweet connection that comes when you're walking in the light and they're walking in the light, and Jesus' blood is washing you and washing them, and it's that sin factor that messes up relationship. But Jesus comes to take it away. He said, I didn't come to condemn the world. I came to save it. He came to remove, to pay for all our sins. And now Paul says, guys, don't be deceived. If you walk in the flesh, those that practice these things of the flesh, he says, I forewarn you. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't go after the fleshly ways. But if you say, how do I do it? Well, this is what Paul's talking about. He says, there is a fruit of the Spirit that God has for you to experience a whole new level of life, a whole new dimension of His Spirit working through you. And we've gone over these different qualities or these different fruits of the Spirit as they're referred to. The first one was love. Then joy, remember? Peace, patience, my favorite. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness we went to last week. And today we come to the last two in the list. Gentleness and self-control. Against such things as these, there is no law. You don't need a law to say, don't do this, don't do that, don't hurt your brother if you're really walking in the Spirit. Because in the Spirit, you're going to, well, Jesus gave that command to his disciples. You love me? They say, yeah, keep my command. What's my commandment? A new commandment I give you? Remember that in John 13, what is it, 34, 35? That you what? Love one another. Even as, he says, as I have loved you. Love one another as I have loved you. That's all we got to do. Walk. It's simple. I mean, I like Jesus, man. He does not make it overly. I don't know about you, but I've heard some preaching that just by the time the guy was done with 20 minutes, my head was swirling. You know, I was like, I can't keep up. This guy is too complex. I mean, he's like making the gospel something it's not. The gospel, the word gospel means what? Good news. I don't know if you're aware of that, but the literal translation of gospel is good news. Now, it is good news that Christ came to pay for my sin. And it is good news that he has offered to me his Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God that can make us anew from within. It can change our lives. And his Spirit, oh, how beautiful it is. But I'm really glad he didn't lead off Paul the list of the fruits of the Spirit with these last two, because I would have probably choked. I notice that they're in a particular order. I know Paul was a pretty seasoned pastor by this point. He probably knew he'd start us off soft and work it in, you know. That's what I think. I mean, well, you tell me if you notice this. The first fruit, love, joy, peace. Doesn't that sound like, you know, yeah, we need that. That's good. Kindness, yeah, goodness, oh, yeah. Oh, I skipped over patience because I didn't like that one. And then I hate waiting, right? I mean, you know people that are like, God, give me patience and give it to me now. I heard a guy on the television last night. He's a Filipino pastor. I just flipped through the channels, and I by chance came on this broadcast that was coming, and he says, be careful, those of you that are praying for immediate answer to this prayer, that God would grant you complete patience with all of your problems. He said, because if God honors your prayer, you'll be dead. Because there's no way to work that much work in such a short period of time without taking you out. I thought, this Filipino pastor is funny, man. He has got it. He's telling the truth, though. I mean, sometimes we're praying for stuff, and we want this super amount of this particular thing, and God's going, you need to grow. And, you know, growth takes time. Growth does take time. You know, this is what Ron Miller, our dear missionary friend in Thailand that went over there to do the orphanage works, he has such a heart for evangelism. If there's someone that doesn't know the Lord and Ron hears about it, man, he will be praying for that person fervently. And he'll be praying for opportunity, either for him to go share the gospel with them or somebody. You know, he doesn't care who it is that, he's not like, it's all about me. It's about God's work. Whoever it is, God sends someone to that person. Please save them, Lord. Such a heart for them to come to know the Lord. And I love that he has that passion for that. But he would tell me, you know, there's some people really messed up. They need the Lord. And we introduced them to Jesus. And I'm not a pastor. You are. Here, you take them now. And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, I have no patience to watch them grow. They're messed up. It's going to take a while. I know. But I just, you know, that's what you pastors do. I'm just an evangelist. You know, that's how he put it. I'll introduce them to Jesus. You help them grow up now. And he recognized he had no patience to watch the fruit begin to develop in a person's life, these fruits of the Spirit. He said, how can you be so patient? I said, I grew up on a farm. You know, those of you that have been on a farm, you know that you don't just take a seed, pop it in the ground, and have instant crop. It's a process. It takes time. And certain fruits take longer to develop than others. I mean, I don't know about you, but since I've been in Hawaii, I'm like learning. So I've been here now almost 25 years. I have figured out what you can grow here, and there it is. Awesome. It's like limitless. This is like we're in the greenhouse, man. We can grow whatever. I came from the desert. You had to work hard. You missed watering a plant one day. It died. Here, like, you don't even have to turn on the water. The Lord sprinkles from the sky, you know. We just nightly, he just rains a little bit, mists it, keeps it. Everything grows. But I've come to like some of these Hawaii fruits that we didn't grow up with in Arizona. Papayas, you know, mangoes, lychees, yeah, rambutans, chabotacabas. There's so many cool fruits here that, you know, we didn't have those big, hairy little red. Have you seen those fruits that they look like they're from Mars? And then you cut them open, they got that white fleshy stuff. It's really, like, just mild and tender and, like it's like an oversized grape with someone put a little bit of but the inside has that, like, texture of a grape but flavor of, I don't know, kiwi mixed with a grape. And it, man, my mouth's watering. I should have stopped talking about this. But anyway, for those of you that know anything about growing fruit, my neighbor had a dwarf mango tree. Dwarf, like, and I mean, the thing was short, like 8 feet tall, like a little bell shape, you know. They trimmed it, and it was just like a little mushroom top on it, and it was short, and you could just go up and big old mangoes. And I was like, I want one of these. So after we got some of the mangoes, we took the seeds and I planted them. And I got them to grow, and I put them in pots, and I got them to transfer them to the garden. And those of you who've been to my house, or you can come next week for Super Bowl and see, the mango tree that is in the front of my, right when you pull up to my house in the corner, that big mango tree that's on the wall there, that I grew that tree from a seed. Not like I grew it. God did all the work. I just put the thing in the ground and he made it grow. But I've also planted some really awesome strawberry papayas. I like the strawberry ones the best. And so I put a whole bunch of those seeds down. And when you grow a strawberry papaya, for those of you who don't know, you start from a seed, put it in the ground, it'll grow into a tree that's about 6 foot high within about 6 months, and by the ninth month, you've got fruit. You're eating strawberry papayas from that seed. It took 9 months from seed to fruit. Do you know how long it takes to go from seed to fruit for a mango tree? Those of you? Anyone got an idea? Guess. It takes 6 years minimum till you see your first fruits. Five if it just had, everything was absolutely perfect. We did get one mango on the fifth year. It was awful. Had to put some fertilizer, baby that tree along, prune it. 6 year, got a couple more. It wasn't until the seventh year that, and those ones were not very good either. They were kind of small. You know, when the tree is young, it just puts out this, like, not really all that developed, much what we call mature fruit. It's fruit, but it ain't that good. And if you wonder how come I have patience with people when I see little green hard fruit of the Spirit in their life, it's because I recognize it took a while to grow those mangoes. We're now on like the eighth, ninth year of crop, and our mangoes have gotten big. And they went from really stringy a couple years ago to they're actually getting juicy and nice and starting to look like mature, like the tree is maturing. And with believers, when they're new, you might see just a little bit of the patience or a little bit of the kindness or a little fruit of each of these fruits of the Spirit. But it's kind of green and hard and stringier, you know. It's not the best. What would a farmer say you got to do? Just keep watering it, keep giving it the fertilizer, and give it time to what? To grow. Don't kick yourself if you do not have all of these fruits in full maturity in your Christian experience already. Because I bet if I went around here and asked everyone here who's been in Christ over 10 years, 20 years, let's do that. Everyone in Christ over 20 years, raise your hand. We have quite a, this is, talk about a nice crowd to preach to. I got a whole bunch of hands went up. Do you have all of these fruits in fullness? You have a full, I mean, when they look at you, they're like, man, that guy has such peace. He's got such patience. Just abounding in kindness. Dottie said, I'm sweet. She says, somebody's going to think so. We love you, Dot. Guys, it takes time. And one thing I've learned about the Lord is he's very patient with me. The hard part is we don't recognize when he says love one another the way I loved you. How much did he love us? Today we're going to look at this because the last two fruits, they typify, I mean, there's no greater example for me to follow. Whenever I try to pick good biblical examples for these fruits to bring out, you know, from the stories in the Bible to help, you know, bring our understanding more in depth in these areas of these fruits. But the last two fruits in my Bible, it says, are gentleness and self-control. If you have a King James, it's meekness. Meekness, that's the old King James word, meekness and self-control. What is meekness anyway? Gentleness, meekness. What does it really mean to be gentle or meek? Does it mean that, is meekness a synonym for weakness? No. This is very important to learn today, that there are not synonyms. They're not equal. You can't switch them in a sentence and say, you know, Jesus was meek, Jesus was weak. No, Jesus was meek, but not weak. He's humble, but he wasn't weak. In fact, he's going to tell his disciples, you know, near the end of the Gospels, no man takes my life. I do what? I give it. I lay it down. No one can take my life. Now, you can't make that claim unless you have some kind of power to back it up. Did Jesus have the power to back up that claim? You remember in the garden when they came to arrest him and Peter whips out the sword to protect the Lord and he lops off the servant of the high priest. He whacks his ear off. And Jesus tells Peter, put that away. Look, if I needed protection, I could ask my Father in heaven. He could send me, what? Thousands of legions. A legion is a thousand. Thousands of angels to take care of this. I'm supposed to drink this cup. Remember, he told his disciples, this cup I have to drink. I'm going to go and die for you. Now, let me just have you turn to John's gospel because there is no better example of this power, what I call with restraint. Jesus had the power. He could have said, you ain't arresting me. Or at any point along the way, he could have said, that's it. I quit. And he could have actually done something about it. But he chose to take that power and not use it to take care of himself. Who was he looking out for? Us. Yeah, this is where real meekness is typified. The best example I can show you of gentleness is gentleness, really, in order to be true gentleness, it has to be demonstrated by someone who has great power. Because if they don't have power and they don't do anything about it, we just think, well, you didn't do anything about it because you were weak. There's nothing you could do about it. But what if you have the power to do something about it and you still don't use the power to take care of you, but instead use that power to take care of others? This is where power with real restraint is demonstrated by the Lord. He took his disciples and he told them in John 15, if you look with me at John 15, verse 12, he says, this is my commandment that you love one another. Greater love has no man than this, than one would lay down his life for his what? His friends. And then he turned to them and said, you are my friends. If you do what I, what? Command. Well, what did he just command them? Love. If you do what I command you, if you love one another, then it's all good. You are my friends. Now, Jesus says, just go down, if you would, just a verse or two. He says right here, he says in verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you that you would go and bear fruit, and that your fruit would remain. And so that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he would give it to you. Now this I command you, that you love one another. How many times does he say love one another in this few verses? Three times. And we've only covered five verses. He's already at three. Do you think Jesus had a stuttering problem? Love one another. What did I say? Oh, yeah. Oh, love one another. Oh, yeah. Love one another. You think he didn't know what he was saying? He had no studying problem at all. In fact, every time Jesus got done preaching, he'd say, let those that have an ear to hear, let them hear what the Spirit says. You know, sometimes our spirit needs a multiple whack. Gib slap. Pack, pack, pack. You know, wake up. Love one another. Wake up. Love one another. Duh. What am I supposed to do? Love one another. It's like the Lord has to just, I don't know if you realize this. When you read about the apostles, did they have it together? No. These guys were messed up. And yet Jesus was so patient with them, and Jesus called them his friends. And he said, I'm going to go die for you. Well, if you just turn a couple pages farther into the Gospel of John, we get to the passage where Jesus is in the garden. It's in chapter 18, by the way, to where Judas is going to come betray him with a kiss. You guys know this part, right? He's going to give away the identity of Jesus there in that garden of Gethsemane. And he'll go and bring the Roman cohort and the officers with him. And it says here in verse 4 that Jesus, knowing all things that were coming upon him, that he went forth. And he said to them, whom do you seek? The guys are coming to the garden to arrest him. He goes out to meet him. Who are you guys looking for? And they answered him, Jesus the Nazarene. And he said to them, I am he. And actually, the word he is an English translation. We put that in. It's really, he said, I am. Kind of a big deal. Because if you don't know the story, remember when Moses said, who do I say sent me, Lord? And he was visiting the Lord in that burning bush. He said, I am that I what? Yeah. I am. Jesus says, I am. Well, this part I have real issue with the movie makers today. Somebody forgot to read the book. I mean, if you're going to make a movie about Jesus, shouldn't you include the details from the script? In your movie, listen to what happens. This I am, this declaration, what was he saying? I am God. He's got power. And Judas, it said also, who was betraying him, was standing with them. And so he said to them, I am. I'm sorry. So when he said to them, I am, John reports something happened. What happened? They never put this in the movie, by the way. This is where I want to ask Mel Gibson, could we do a little outtake extra scene? Special feature? Could you do this part? Because this part is powerful. Jesus, when he said, John tells us, so when Jesus said, I am, they, it says, drew back and fell to the ground. They literally were what we call face planted. Down. They stepped back and fell down. And Jesus said, therefore, it says, again, he asked them, whom do you seek? And they said, Jesus the Nazarene. Now, where are they? They're laying on the ground. Who are you looking for? Let's get this straight. Who are you looking for? They're all like going, how did I get pinned to the ground? Whoa, what's happening? And he goes, I told you, I am. And so it says, he spoke to them, I told you I am. So if you seek me, if you're looking for me, let's get one thing clear. These ones, they get to go their way. Who's he looking out for? His disciples. To fulfill the word which he spoke, of those whom of whom you have given me, Jesus is speaking, I have not lost one. Let's get this straight. You guys can take me, but you don't get to take them. Now, Peter, you know, he was the zealous one. He's the one that had that little sword. And Simon Peter, having the sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave's ear, cut off the right ear. And the slave's name was Malchus. And it says, so Jesus said to Peter, put away that sword into its sheath. The cup which the Father has given me, shall I not drink it? Put it away. Now, those of you guys know Luke. What was Luke's occupation before? He was a physician. You want a little extra credit reading? Go read this account in Luke's gospel. Because when Peter lops off the ear, Luke mentions this little detail, you know, which they got to put in the extra scenes too. Because when the ear flops off, what's Jesus do? Picks it up. I'm guessing he dusted it off. I don't know. And then, Malchus, come here. And he put his ear back on. Can you imagine the testimony that would be to the high priest? Because it's the high priest's servant. And whether anyone else would realize this, Jesus was giving a in-your-face testimony to the high priest. Because that servant would go home knowing my ear was flopping on the ground. And Jesus stopped the guy who had the sword and took my ear and put it back. Can you imagine Malchus like going, whoa, like it's on. It's. How do you think it made that servant feel? Here's Jesus. They're coming to arrest him. They're going to beat him. He knows the cup he's about to drink. But does he use his power to look out for himself? No, he looks out for the slave. He looks out for his disciples. Look, you guys came for who? Me. Who are you going to leave with? They don't show it like he's in power, like he's in control. But this is true meekness. To have the power, but not to use it lavishly on you, that's really the Spirit of God. See, if we have power, our flesh is so selfish. Who do we use our powers to help? Us. Whereas Jesus sets me an example of using my power not for me. And then, back to Galatians 5:22. And what was that last fruit of the Spirit? Self-control. The one that, no matter how long these Christians have been going, I always hear them say things like, I could always use a little more of that. Yeah, I mean, the honest ones. Okay, let's just go down to the ones that are really honest, the older, mature Christians will say, I still got room to grow in that area of self-control. It is something that Jesus showed the greatest restraint. Because if I had the power to make those guys fall on their cans right by just saying, I am, and I'm about to go get beaten by them, and I'm just establishing, look, guys, you came for me, not them. They go free. Oh, put the ear back on. Okay. You, out of the way, I'm going to go with you. There you go, free, right? We got that? Do I need to say I am again? Because you see, I could just see him dusting off. Whoa, what was that? I'll go with you. They go free, right? Do you want me to say I am? I mean, he could have done that. Boom, they would have fallen down. Now, if you read one of the other gospel accounts, you find out it's recorded they went down twice. John just says that when Jesus said, I am, they went down. Read Matthew and Mark. See what it says. A little extra credit. It's really cool. But why don't they put that in the movie? He had the power. And yet he said, no man takes my life. I give it. I'll go with you. And even on the cross when the thieves were next to him saying, save yourself and save us. If Jesus would have saved himself, by the way, could he have been on the cross and just said, I'm out of here? Pull his hands out of the nails and you were a real annoying. Zot, so you're gone. You know, he could have taken out all the bad guys and he could have had legions of angels come and just swoop down and wipe out those crumbs. And but if he would have saved himself, could he have saved us? No. This is where power gets used to look out for others. Really, self-control is one of those most ultimate expressions of us no longer putting the eyes on who? Us. We begin to say, Lord, I don't want to do what my flesh would want to control me to do. I don't want to be bound to that. Let me, because if we, what's it say in the next verse in Galatians 5:23? Again, such things like these, there is no law. Verse 24 says, now those that belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. And if we live by the Spirit, listen to this, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become boastful and challenging one another or envying one another. Let's do the things of the Spirit the way they were meant to be lived. You know, you weren't meant to grow in the fruits of the Spirit so you could go, yeah, I got more patience than you, ha, ha, ha. I'm so much better. I challenge you. Let's have a patience duel. You know? And what? But some Christians, they're goofy, man. They come up with these stupid challenges. And I'm like, that's not even right. That's not what the whole things of the Spirit are about. We're supposed to walk by the Spirit so we don't walk after the flesh. So we overcome the flesh. And when it comes to that very last fruit, self-control, man, I am so grateful that's in the list, because this is one that I needed great amounts of. I only had self-control in certain areas of my life. And it would take God's Spirit to work inside, a remaking of this man that's sitting in front of you, that would change to where now the self-control, what I have, it comes from a submission to, well, I learned it from Jesus. Jesus, I don't do what I want to do. I'm not here to do my will. I came to do whose will was he interested in doing? The Father's. I came to do the Father's will. And when he taught them to pray, remember? Our Father, which art in heaven, they said, show us how to pray. Hallowed be high and lifted up be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Where? On earth, as it is in heaven. Thy, what? Thy will be done? Now, when Jesus was in the garden right before they came to arrest him, he said, Father, I don't want to drink this cup. Do you remember that? Who remembers that in the scripture? But nevertheless, he said, not what? Not my will, but your will. If you really want to grow in the area of self-control, start praying that prayer. Just say, God, let me do your will, not mine. You will find it's an inner working, but the Spirit will, like, he fine-tunes you from within. If you get that thing tuned right on within, guess what starts to come out? You know, all we have to do, the Bible says even out of the mouth, out of our mouth, it says proceeds everything that fills our what? Our heart. Some guys tell me, Pastor, I have no self-control. When it comes to swearing, I swear like a truck driver. I said, I was a truck driver. And I can swear multiple languages. That's the worst part when you grow up speaking a different language, is that you don't, that's the first words they teach you, swear words. At least when you're around a bunch of Sicilians on a job site, I'm here to tell you, they do know how to swear. Maybe you don't know Sicilian, so you don't know, but you probably could figure it out from the hand gestures and the, you know, the things that, you get it from body language pretty quick. Well, when you want to change that what's coming out of your mouth, something like, I got to change it, Pastor. I have no self-control when it comes to my swearing. Well, I don't need to worry about trying to put a clamp on your lips, you know, a zipper, and throw away the key. You know, those people go, meek, meek. That doesn't work. Because inwardly, they're still going, they're cursing inside. You want to change what comes out of your mouth? Change what's where in your heart. And that that's where self-control is a real fruit of the Spirit, because God goes in with his Spirit and changes in here. And then what comes out of here just starts to change, because this is just controlled by this. We just got to get guys to walk in the Spirit. Just walk in the Spirit. You will overcome the flesh and you will grow. Listen, for you ones just starting out, Phaedra, have patience, okay? Don't worry. God has patience. No, you don't even have to. Just let God, just understand we have a very patient God. And he is like the farmer that's waiting for the fruit. He knows the mangoes are not going to be here for 8 or 9 years. He knows there are certain fruits of the Spirit in your life that are going to take a while to develop. Don't be foolish and think, well, I want them all now, and I want them all mature, and God give me patience and give it to me in full measure now. He's going to take you home to answer that prayer. Because there's no way to give you full patience unless that fruit grows. God is patient God, isn't he? We need to remember to look at people as his workmanship. Because the Bible says that we are Christ's workmanship, created in Christ. And what's it say there in Philippians? He who began a good work in you will be what? Faithful to complete it. Don't be bummed out if the work isn't done already. Just know God is at work. And it's a process, and you will grow. And he will prune your branch. Anything not good, he'll cut away. That's not him punishing you. You know, we prune these trees all around this beach for a reason. Because they used to look like little scraggly sticks with no canopies on them that was healthy. And we had to go in and take away all the dead wood. Because once one of these branches die here, they have these little black carpenter bees. Have you guys seen those things that look like black bumblebees? They go in, they find a dead branch, and they burrow a hole up in it. And once they get in the branch, they start heading down toward the trunk. And you can tell right where they've passed, because everything from where they burrowed in and head downward will be dying. And when we first came here, man, we had them galore. I had to go in and trim out all those dead branches because that was their house. They didn't like me, the poor bees that, you know. But one day we were worshiping. My wife had her hair down. Those of you guys don't know, she has it up today. But when it's down, it's like down to here. And long and nice and straight blonde hair. And one of those bees thought she was a flower. Flew right into her hair. And it went right here by her head and was trapped in the hair. And I'm leading worship up here. And I'm like, I don't care. It's just part of, it's a boy thing. You know, it's like, she's my wife. So I went over there and I grabbed that bee and I put my hand around her hair and I had to go like this. And her hair's so long, I had to go all the way down. And it's in my hand and it is mad. And I'm like, boom. No more. That's it. We got to trim the branches. Now, when we prune these branches, guess what happened to these trees? They began to make these little flowers that you see. And the flowers in the Auntie Kalani, the Hawaiian woman that blessed us years ago and let us come here, she says to us, these haven't flowered for 26 years. She said, you're anointed by God. Whatever you touch comes to life. And I was thinking, I'm cutting away the dead stuff to make the tree healthy. That's what you do on a farm. What about the dead stuff in us? You know, spiritual dead stuff. Those fruits of or deeds of the flesh. Do we need those to stick around? No. We need to cut those out so that the true healthy branches that can grow the fruit of the Spirit can grow in us. That's what Paul is trying to describe to them. Walk in the Spirit. You'll overcome the flesh. And that dead stuff, that'll fall away. And people will see a change in you. They'll be like, wow, there really changes. And they might even come to you. I'm pretty sure there's a God now. And you're like, what made you think that? You've never even come to church. I don't need to. I've seen you change. And whatever it is you got, I want. Now, when they do that, you know you're on the right path. because the Lord is changing you from within, and it's exciting. Isn't it exciting when the Lord does that? Where your own family or your friends can see, wow, there's something going on, man. That's the fruit of the Spirit. That's what I want to encourage. Now, next week, we're going to get to chapter 6. Finally. Woohoo! Only took me like 10 weeks to do. I don't know. This is part 9 of chapter 5. But it's okay. You know what? I don't mind if it helps one person grow in their understanding of these. Are these fruits of the Spirit, are they really precious to the Lord? He said, you didn't choose me. I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear what? Much fruit. He wants these fruits in our lives. And guys, I mean, he told his disciples, this is how people will know truly you're my disciple. What's the first fruit that in the list again? Love. Do you notice that that's the one he said that men will know that we're his disciples? Because we have love for one another. The very first one he develops, I notice, in all believers is that fruit of love. And if you're not all the way down to self-control and gentleness yet, don't worry. Those are like mango trees, okay? They take a while till those fruits appear. But let him increase you in love and joy and peace and patience. Let him do those fruits that pop up quick. And let him continue to work in you so you can just enjoy. There's a sweetness to a believer who has the plethora of all of these fruits in their life. It's just so nice to run into Christians that have a maturity where they actually have all the fruits in the basket. You just look at them and you're like, man, they got patience, they got kindness, they got self-control, they got gentleness. I mean, I meet some of those older saints and I think, I can't wait. Someday I'm going to be there. You know? And if we're to get to that place, it's so that we can help someone else, right? To help them come along to that place. Maybe they're struggling and they just need some encouragement. And some of you, as your fruit matures, you will see God put other people in your life that you can now demonstrate to them how to abide in Jesus. Just stay with the Lord. Hang in there. You can do it. And as you abide in him, he'll abide in you, and you will bear fruit. That's the whole secret. It's not hocus pocus, anything hard to figure out. You just stick with the Lord. You stick with the Lord, he'll stick with you, and you'll bear much fruit. And it's a sweet thing. And only you know if you're really sticking with the Lord. I mean, I wish that there was a way that we had like a little light that said, yes, the abiding light, right? We have a little like glowy green light that says, yep, this guy's abiding. Yep, she's abiding. You know, light's on. Green. Yep, it's good. I wish that we came with one of those. Just like I used to walk to my wife and say, penny for your thoughts. I don't know where. It's an old movie. I learned this thing. Penny for your thoughts. I did that to my wife once in our early days. Penny for your thoughts. And she says, if God wanted you to know my thoughts, there would be a screen on my forehead with them just flowing by. She wasn't willing to share. I knew I did something wrong. Maybe it's better we don't know when the light's on and not on. Because we judge each other. But you know what? This is one thing you know inside you. Are you abiding? Or are you telling Jesus, Jesus, why don't you just wait over here? I got to go do some, stuff that's not your gig. You know, I don't think he'd be pleased with me because I'm going to go over here and sin. And you just stay here. That's not abiding. Abiding means remaining with him. Jesus came so that you would never have to feel alone. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. But do we leave the Lord? See, this is the part where abiding, we get messed up. We leave him. Not he left us. By the way, if you feel God is far away from you, you know that saying, guess who moved? It sure wasn't him. He's right there with you. It's you that has walked away. Come back. Like the prophet would cry out, Isaiah, he'd say, come back to the Lord. Remember how he cried out? All of Israel, there was a really lot of backsliders. Backslidden, he said, in heart. They had slid away from the Lord. He said, come back to the Lord, all ye backsliders. That was a prophetic call. You know, the prophecy, the prophet saying, everybody who's far from the Lord, come back to the Lord. God wants you. Does God want the prodigal son to come back? Remember that prodigal son story? He gets in a bad way. He walks away from his dad. And when the father sees the son coming back, what's he do? Get the best robe. Get my ring. Let's have a party. My son who was dead is now what? Alive. You know, how come the church doesn't, when they see somebody who's backslidden, they come back to church? You know what the church does, right? Oh, you're a backslider. Kick him. You know, they like beat the guy. What does the Lord do? He's like, welcome home. We need to have a party. But you know, it's those Christians that were faithful. They're like, I've been here the whole time. We never had a party for me. That's what the big brother said, remember, in the story? Well, I never had no party for me. And the father told that, the one that was faithful, look, you've been with me all this time. All I have is yours. But this brother who was dead is now alive. If you're backslidden, you're hearing me tell this message, I'm telling you, God's Spirit is calling to you, come back. Come out of your backsliding. He welcomes you back. And we welcome you back. I want you to know, really, we do. We rejoice. The Bible says, God, the angels in heaven rejoice when just one sinner turns to the Lord, right? They have a party. The whole angels go, party! Man, another sinner got saved. It's a party. That's what they rejoice over. Why does the church, we've forgotten that. Do you think that's important? We should be like, you know, some backslider comes back to the church, we should go, party! Backsliding party, he's back. You know, no, it's not backsliding party. Back from backsliding. Back from back. You're here. Let's party. Glad to see you party. Man, we need to change our attitude to the attitude of the Father. Because he rejoices when guys come back, doesn't he? He's like, welcome back from the dead, my son. Come back. That's the cry of the Spirit. If you can hear that, you know, Jesus always end with, let those that have an ear to hear, let them hear. You have some friends that might need to hear this. So let them know. The Spirit of God says, come back. You are always welcome back to the Lord. The Lord wants you out of that place of death. He wants you to experience the life, the love, the real fruit of his Spirit. It's beautiful. Well, that's enough for today. Let's pick up next week in Galatians 6. If you get a chance, read ahead. This week, if you do have time to come out to our Tuesday night study at the Regency Retirement Home on Ahualai Road, we're going to be having an awesome time. It's Ephesians chapter 5, the part where we get the traditional wedding vows. Husbands, love your wives the way Christ, what? Love the church. And we're going to break that down. And if you just need a little boost, infusion of encouragement for your relationship, and this counts not just for you married ones, for the ones that are courting, want to know how to do it right, you want to come out on Tuesday and hear this, because it's really, man, some powerful words in Ephesians 5 to give us great insight how to live our relationships out in marriage. So very enriching, and I really want to encourage you in that. So read that also ahead if you have time. Ephesians 5, Galatians 6 for next week. And let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this sweet passage of Scripture, Lord, we've been able to delve into so deeply. I especially appreciate that we can look at your Son, the one that typifies the fullness of every one of these fruits, that sets the greatest example, Lord, for us that we could walk after. Lord, help us to imitate your Son, Jesus. Lord, we want to be imitators, like Paul said, of him, that we could set a good example for those that would need an example how to follow you. Lord, increase us in these fruits. Help us to overcome and put aside the things of the flesh. Let us, instead of walking after the flesh, let us walk after your Spirit this week. Bless us, Lord, with strength to do that. And I ask that now in Jesus, your Son's precious name. In Christ's name we pray. Everyone that agreed with me said? Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.